I was surprised at that when I heard it as well.
I hope you challenge this, Stuart. I'll bring you in now. What I will say is that we're the business committee here. So when the review's done, with this business committee, we'll be looking at the business case for the floral pavilion. So that's a bit of a pre-warning there, Stuart. So you will be coming back. Ron?
Yes, thank you, Chair. I think I have to intervene in the opposite, because if you're going to do a comparison, you should do what I think is correct. The impact phase has never been public ownership. It's never been private ownership. It operates as a private theatre, so turning the full pavilion to the impact phase is entirely intact. You have to understand, the acts that the floral attract are probably not the same magnitude the impact attract. Simply to go up and to go up and council ownership.
So yes, so Winter Garden is in council ownership.
And that has to rely on what activities they put on. I'm sure Winter Garden needs to be touched on it, because the amount of time that it's empty, you can't operate without it. So we have to be fair in our answer or anything. I think it's his recognition that smaller theatres do need some support throughout their lifetime, and I think it should be a diminishing issue, because they should be standing on their own 2 feet throughout the process. I mean, that's what we should be looking at. Is that process robust enough to actually deliver the objects that it will stand on its 2 feet and generate an income that can be returned back to the taxpayer? That would be a big example. That's what we should be looking at, not castigating people for maybe not having the right answer.
I wonder whether I actually castigated anybody for their controlling the officers.
That's challenging, Chair.
I'm meant to be challenging. David, I'll bring you in here.
It's only a comment to leave on the floor. The floor is a superb facility. It's also a significant challenge, because of course it wasn't just built as a theatre. It's built as a theatre and a conference centre. And Stuart said the subsidy is coming down here and here. What Stuart and the King and what they are doing is working with the manager at service to make sure that we can clear away the obstacles that are within the bigger council, if you like, the people who are trying to run that one theatre. Maybe things to do with procurement or things that take time or approvals to do things where we can cut away some of that and actually give that one site and other sites greater autonomy. I mean, one example that sticks in my mind is that if you take the West Coast and Lake people, the sports team that are out there, they've raised tens of thousands of additional income just by using the assets they've got in a slightly different way. So the rimboes that they use on the lake, they now offer tours to go around to Hillary Island and so on. People say, yeah, they are quite expensive, and they are, but actually what they're doing is they're using their time and their assets that are there already, and they're generating additional income, which helps offset the cost of running the lake. So we have to make sure that the climate is right across all our organisations to allow those things to happen. But you're right, the floor is a particular challenge. You know, it's got the conference side, which in an ideal world would have at least another big hotel somewhere near it. It's got an undeveloped area at the back, which again has future potential. So it is a real outstanding asset when people run from other councils to see it as that. But yeah, it is a challenge to get it down to breaking even. And of course the other thing is it offers a year-round variety of entertainment. Some things which probably won't cover their costs, but some of it is offset by the others on the following week or following week. So it isn't as strictly commercial as a purely commercial aspect, but it is something we're working on. The ideas that Stuart and Nicky have called help support the managers in those positions.
I think that was a good way to end there. Thank you, David. Yeah. I am not understand. Ian, can I ask a question, please?
Thanks. Can I ask a question to Stuart and Anthony? Like you, it's very interesting, your presentation and the work that you're doing to listen to staff and to ask them for their ideas. But as I've been listening tonight, one group that perhaps you do need to pay particular attention to, and I know you have a personal interest in this, Chair, I think the likes of the Friends groups that help to run the likes of the Lions and the Leisure Centres and the assets that we have. I found through personal experience that very often they have good ideas, but they find it very difficult to get those ideas either heard, let alone implemented, that could provide a more beneficial service to the wider public. And I was just wondering, is there a mechanism within the work that you're doing? doing to allow those sort of organisations to have a say or to put their ideas forward as well.
I think that's something that we can take away from this session in terms of developing the commercial strategy and how we engage, like you say, with members but also with our local community groups as well. So yes, we've started with staff, so how do we then roll that out? What do members, what would members find useful? How can we help shape and influence and also our the voice of our sort of residents through the community groups as well. So I think that's definitely something we take forward and we'd like to try and shape that into the strategy as part of the communications thread.
That was actually a really good point and I'm glad Ian raised it. There's groups out there, friends groups and voluntary groups, more and more voluntary groups, and we need them. And I've been 2 years in the library of my ward. And we found the council more of a hindrance than a help. And that has definitely got to change. It's got to change. Anybody else? Well, Nicky, Stuart, thank you. It was an excellent presentation. And I think we've learnt a lot here tonight. So we look forward to seeing you again very soon. I'd like the committee to note that before.
Thank you.
The LCR update and Rosemary's coming up, Rosemary Boylan. Rosemary, I think you've come to these committees more often than I do. Thanks, Rosemary.
Thanks, Chair. Good evening, everyone. Can you hear me all right? Okay, so this is the latest from our regular update on City Region activity and developments. A bit of a snapshot of some of the activity, as I always say, there's a whole range of diverse activity going on. This is usually just a snapshot, and as I always say, if you want any more detail on what's going on, just get in touch with me. The issues I picked up on there are the first and there on my authority to the plan. So most people have obviously joined the coast now for a couple of months and he's busy with the statutory office. And he recently published his new day plan, which is a summary and an overview, very much a sort of first step to a long term plan about the key activity and focus in the first few months of his office, really. Just to make a couple of points, obviously the significant deliveries are already underway, as we know, there's a whole range of activity ongoing. The 100-day plan is structured around five thematic pillars which I recognised from when Steve produced his original manifesto. So that's ambitious, fair, green, connected and together. And I think I put a link in the report, but if you look at the detail of the 100-day plan, under each of those headings is a whole range of projects and activity that's ongoing, and I just sort of highlighted a couple of those for you. So the first one is ambitious, and this is very much about the potential of economic growth for the city region. This is very much about developing the talents of people and places and businesses. And the plan has a couple of focus initiatives really. The first one is around achieving the way skills serve. And we all agree it's really important, we've had this conversation before, to really understand what businesses need, what skills they're looking to develop in the future. The second one is publishing the International Business Festival programme for 2018, building on the previous successful International Business Festivals that have taken place across the city region. There's also a move to launch a strategic economic review. So we've got a strategic document in place, but really to making sure what opportunities are coming in the future, we've got a really strong evidence base for that to see where potential growth is. And again, looking at city region representation and big trade show, the UK and international. So they're just in relation to the economy. The second key pillar is around fair, and this is to make sure really that any benefits of economic growth are distributed fairly across the city region, and in particular some of our most vulnerable groups benefit from those opportunities. So just to highlight a couple of examples there, a pledge around to sign along towards problems, which is just taking place, I think, and that's really about promoting issues relevant to the armed forces and veterans, and to make sure that...
Can I just mention on the armed forces now, I've got a vested interest being retired military myself. The way, can I just say, the way we treat our armed forces in this prison is a national scandal. So I hope, and I'll come on to it later when I talk about the scrutiny committee's report. So I do hope that this is being taken seriously and not just paying lip service. Because when Iraq was on in Afghanistan, we saw the Prime Minister, and it's not part of political this, and the leader of the opposition standing up and saying, this person's just died, this person's just died, and these are heroes, and the armed forces do tremendous work. But the way we treat the veterans in this country, right across the country, is a national disgrace. So I hope we pick up on this and run with it. Thank you. I wanted to say that. Thank you.
Thank you. I think it's a level of the sort of commitment that that really needs, that the kind of pledge has been made. I don't think some actions have helped with that. Second key focus on the Housing First report. This is really to tackle homelessness across the city region, particularly rough sleepers and the very visible presence of rough sleepers that we've increasingly seen over the last couple of years. A broad overarching approach to establish a fair and social justice advisory board, so that's to look at really how we can make sure that all of these vulnerable groups actually get their interests represented across the city region. A commitment to around mental health, to really level the focus around mental health, to look at best practice and innovation excellence in tackling with mental health across the city region, and a pledge to consult on fair and early childhood. Okay, the third. The third strand is around green, commitment to the environment, and particular focus around a couple of things really. One is a commitment to produce a local journey survey. So the vast majority of journeys across the city region are very, very localised, less than 5 or 10 kilometres, and yet there's a real lack of investment in public transport. It's a commitment to look at innovation around how we can do something much more proactively to encourage walking and cycling and use of public transport. A real commitment to developing opportunities around the Mercantile Commission. So we've got the river, we've got more time, big priorities for ourselves in the world. So real focus on looking at opportunities around the Mercantile College, which will take place in the next few months. Rolling out the next fleet of low-emission buses, successfully existing approach to roll out more across the city region. And then look at opportunities to improve the situation air quality. And again, this committee of 51 and the past year has been a really big priority for us. Connected is around physical and digital infrastructure. So looking at logistics and transport and rail as well as digital infrastructure to make it the best it can possibly be across the city region. So a couple of examples there, focusing on rail opportunities. So for us, again, big priority. Talking to the Welsh Government around cross-border land opportunities, but also how the city region can engage across the wider network, across the North West, and opportunities that we have HS2. Commitment to publish a city region road safety strategy. Again, it's been picked up on this committee in the past, and this is a priority in terms of building out some roads quite stark for this around road safety. As I said, a focus on digital connectivity, so a real priority around looking at innovation and best practice and making sure the city region can really be the best in its game in terms of digital innovation. Looking at affordable transport, again, the point I made before is it's great having sort of growth and focus on transport, but it needs to be inclusive, so it's a particular commitment to look at purposes and making sure that costs to travel across the city region aren't worrying. And finally, publishing the city region long-term growth strategy. Together, this is about looking at across the city region all our individual strengths and assets within each district and how we can bring that together to make sure the city region has value. So again, a couple of examples there that I've highlighted. A commitment to appoint some city region ambassadors. I think we've got quite well-established ambassadors around business and growth. Like this is about a much more inclusive approach, so it's really young people and older people who really serve the city region internationally. Focus on those charities, so this is specific focus on the number of charities there that are doing nice and prioritising really across the patch. He's made a commitment around having a mayoral question tonight, so I think in the run up to the election, Steve Rodman's pledge was really to make sure that you get out of the city, out of Liverpool, and these were the patches and took on board all of these issues where I'm putting question time, for example, how is he going to do that, so it won't take at least one place. in the next few months in each of the six districts. Connected to Home Health and Social Care Summit, again, building on existing activity and on the really good work that's being done around health and social care and opportunities to work more closely with our health partners, bringing the focus around the summit to bring that together. And finally, a summit and a strategy around countering violence and exploiting the girls as a key priority. So, as I said, the detail around all of those is a whole range of projects and initiatives, and it's there on the website, or I've got the detail if you want to have a look at that. The other thing that I've done is just focused on a couple of key current developments that I thought may be of interest. So, the first one is around the Walsall Gateway, imminent opening within the next 4 weeks, we think. So, the second crossing across the River Mersey, 6-lane toll bridge, Silver Jubilee Bridge, obviously, a bit old, a bit dated. Certainly not to the level of volume of traffic that's crossing each day. So a commitment to the year is going to really go to second crossing in and opening in the next 4 weeks later. And that's a centrepiece of a much wider around 9 kilometres of network of roads to really improve linkages across the wider city region. Just going to flag up both Mersey Gateway and Silver Jubilee Bridge will both be toll bridges when they open. Some contention and discussion around that. Again, the detail of the tolling. And just a snapshot of the timelines there. As I say, spring 14 commenced. When the new bridge opens in the next couple of weeks, the Silver Jubilee Bridge will close for at least a year. Spring summer is the intention for that to be open next year. And the two main crossings might be coming. So we all understand the significance of having those regional logistics and infrastructure to support. And the second one I want to flag up is the sort of development of the city region luxury programme, because again, the goal is really intrinsic in this, so the cutting edge is sort of really being softened across both sides of the river. And obviously, Council Care Davis is a core value for economic development and culture in the city region, so Will's playing a key sort of role in leading a lot of this cultural programme. The focus is on really the role of culture and the point that the council made earlier about the point of the role of culture and tourism in the wider sort of economy of the city region, absolutely invaluable as an offer, and we're about to say a key role to play within that. It's very much about placemaking and bigger than our international recognition, looking at a whole series of transformational events building on stuff that's happened over the last couple. Really growing our creative industries and our creative sectors, and again, we've got some really cutting edge businesses in the world that are playing a key part of this, really. It's very much about developing skills and apprentices and opportunities for our young people in those sectors, a focus on film, digital technology. And critically, as well, this is about engaging our communities and our residents in this bigger sense of pride and place and the role that they can play in that. So, just a couple of highlights of what's going to come off. 2018 programmes currently being developed, and a couple of the big events are highlighted there. So the Giants will be back next year. Tall Ships and Clippers, 10 years since the last time the Tall Ships were here, and obviously around moving people watching that, critical for Will playing a key role in that. And conversations now around Will having a major significant role next year when the ships come back. We've put the dates there of that event. And finally, China season. This is again, these are three of a whole range of the international events that we've developed. Again, I can give you more information about those. China season is opening early next year, major exhibition around the terracotta army, cultural interest already. We're looking at a whole programme of complementary events to take place in Rome to match what's going on in the city as well. And I think for all three of those, and indeed for many of the sort of cultural events that have been developed, you can see how we're all really complements and adds value to what's going on in Liverpool and the wider city of Germany. So we're looking at a whole range of ideas and events around next year, World's Year of Cultural Creativity, because I wouldn't underestimate the significance of tourism and leisure and culture in that whole agenda. So that's a quick gallop through, a snapshot of some of the latest developments. Happy to take any questions, and as ever,
excellent presentation. Any questions? Sorry about that.
Just two comments to be made. One is that I'm pleased to see Drew Floyd continuing with the ongoing talks with Wales to make sure that the rail line is electrified at some stage. personally have been involved for over 3 decades in trying to get that forward. I hope the mayor does well. And in 3.5, the second paragraph, focus on the potential of greater collaboration and partnership working with the NHS, something that's failed miserably in my work over the last few weeks. I hope it transpires that we can get the work to work for people and individuals, enabling them to stay healthy longer. Thank you, Chair.
Thanks, David. Thank you, Chair. I want to start by saying how really pleased I am to see that the Metro Mayor is taking action on affordable transport for apprentices. We're seeing massive growth and attraction towards apprenticeships. And I've all had raised consistently in these committees that there's always been a focus on young people going to university, leaving the borough, but there's always been a massive lack of focus on people who actually stay and work within the borough, especially our young people. And I was an apprentice, my first job was an apprentice, and I had to travel to Liverpool every single day. And on apprenticeship wages, you're talking at least 20, 30, 40% of my wages are being spent on transport alone. So I'm really pleased he's looking at addressing that. In terms of homelessness and rough sleeping, it's a very big issue. That's not just in Liverpool, it is in Wirral. Myself and my colleague, Councillor Thomasher, spent an evening with the National Citizen Service, and we slept with a number of people who were homeless in Birkenhead and listened to their stories. So I am pleased that he's taking action with that. But also, especially pleased to look at how we're trying to advance ourselves in terms of tourism. And I'm really pleased that we're having that China season. We've obviously got major business links with China in terms of exports. We need to look at attracting and building those relationships there. And hopefully through China season, we can seek to do that too.
If I'm not rudely interrupted by Dave Mitchell,
heard everyone, you're just stressing.
I'm waiting for you to finish, Chair. I was indicating to speak.
I'll take that on note that after I've finished meeting, Chair. Yes, the first thing I'd like to report is that Anita Leachy has sadly resigned from the committee due to pressure of work and some family circumstances. She's done this lovingly, and she was a great member of the committee, I must say, and her contributions were really very, 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 very good. So I'm sorry about that, but I am glad to say that Gillian Wood is now Anita's replacement, and I'm sure Gillian will do the work, excellent work that Anita did, and Gillian will carry on with that, I'm sure she will. And the other thing to report is that Tom Anderson is now the Conservative spokesperson on the Liverpool City Region. We met last week, Steve Rowland came to our first meeting, and he went over roughly what's been said here today by Rosemary. And he gave a commitment that he was going to come to all our schools, every one of them, which I went on last week when we met, we decided what we were going to look at. And we've decided it's a big group now because we have now got a Liverpool City Region, we've got an elected mayor, and we've got leaders of the council all over the portfolio. So it's a big scrutiny committee and it needs to be. And what we've decided to do, so we can do scrutiny work, as we show, we're going to split the committee into two groups to do most of the scrutiny. So we can do, instead of doing three or four a year, we can do six. Which I think is a good idea. But the first piece of scrutiny we're going to do is spatial development. And we're going to do the whole group because it's crucial. It's controversial, it's going to be controversial in the next couple of years. Brownfield sites being built and all the rest of it. We've got a Liverpool City Region, or we will have a Liverpool City Region. And we're also, that's not diminishing what each borough is doing, what each council is doing. So we've got the six councils within the Liverpool City Region, and I'll stress now, this the metro mayor, it's not a top-down thing, it isn't. So each individual council, like in planning, will be autonomous, and we'll decide as a council, but we will have a Liverpool City Region strategy. So we'll have people within the mayor's office looking at land right throughout the borough and how best it can be used. I welcome that, but I must emphasise that it doesn't diminish what each planning department and what each council does autonomously, and that will continue. So our first piece of work, which I think is going to start in October, early October, we're going to look at the spatial strategy, which is very important, I think. Then we're going to look at things welfare reform. It was touched on there, and I mentioned. We'll look at universal credit when it comes in. I think it's coming in Wirral in November. It's been put out piecemeal by the government. And quite frankly, it's a shambles. What's gone on, there's people waiting 6 weeks without any money whatsoever. There's some people waiting 14, 16 weeks. On the daily poll, I think it might have been this week, there was a Conservative MP saying she's on the committee, and she said in her opinion it should be at least paused so we can look at the problems. And what's happening with universal credit, and Rosemary talked about the homelessness. Well, the universal credit is adding to the problems, and adding to the problems of housing. And we're going to look at that. This is going to be when we split. I want to be on universal credit, make no mistake about that. And we're also going to look at air quality control, because that is another important one. And there's members of the scrutiny committee from other councils. Because there's over 40,000 people in this country a year dying because because of poor quality air. So I think that's something else that needs to be looked at urgently, which can benefit all the councils, I feel. So that's what we're doing. The other thing is, I've mentioned about the Metro Mayor saying he was going to come to each of our meetings, which I'm glad, and he's going to throw some open to questions. And the other thing, which, and this came from me because I think it's important we keep it on the agenda as a standing item, the way we keep the Liverpool City meeting as a standing item on this committee, and that's Brexit. Whether you were a Remainer or a Leaver, it doesn't matter. What matters now is the negotiations that are going on and the outcome by March 2019, because it's going to have ramifications for all of us, whether you wanted to stay in or whether you wanted to leave. It doesn't really matter because that decision will be made. So we're going to keep that as a standing item and we're going to look at it all the time, basically. So that's basically the committee, what the scrutiny committee are up to. We've done some good work in the past, and I think, and we've got an old party group, and we work well together, you know, the same as this committee does on my time. So that's what we're going to be doing in scrutiny for the foreseeable future. Have you got any questions on that?
All my reports are still dependent on the committee for the rest of all the debates.
Did everyone get that?
Yeah.
Mike will forward a report basically outlining what we're doing this year.
The final scrutiny report.
The final scrutiny report, I'm sorry.
And the changes that were mentioned to the position of the committee there to the council.
Warren.
Just to declare interest, Chair, I am a civil servant working for the Department of Work and Pensions, and when any government policy specific to that department is debated at this committee, I will have to leave the room.
That's a natural thing. Yeah, so some of the stuff we're doing in the Liverpool City region, I might add, we will be doing in this in our work, I'll come on to that later on when I go over what our work programme, this committee's work programme is. And some of the stuff we're doing in the Liverpool City region will also be doing. Thank you. So can we note that report, please? Dave?
I did that, Michael. You did? Early on, I was castigated before I had a question. Just 2 points. First of all, I fully concur and agree with you in relation to universal credits, given that as today, 60% of those that appeal have been overturned, which is what a shambles of years. One thing I would want to point out, Chair, is in 6.2, it's a typographical error at all. You've got the chair of one of the select committees, as Nancy Sherman Wire, who's up in Fidelity Games, not a favour. And it's very nice to see the city region having that, but they've actually got opposition members as chairs of the select committee, unlike this or that.
Yes, you're quite right. Sue Maguire is a Lib Dem, and the government stipulated that it has got to be a member of the opposition parties who chairs the scrutiny committee. And it's Sue Maguire. And
the brains of Chief Shops is party supported universal credits.
Please, let's get on with the agenda. Let's get on with the agenda. Item 7. Quarter one Whittle Flam performance, and David's got to bring us up to speed on that. Thanks, David.
Chair, I didn't propose to speak to this item. It's the first quarter report. Many of the outcomes are reported annually, so there are a lot that will flow through later in the year. The report authors brought in a summary. I happily take questions or take points away to get any of the answers. But as I say, because it's quarter one, many of the things are reported.
Thanks for that, David. So I think we've all read, or we certainly should have read the report. David, you had your hand up.
Yes, thank you, Chair. There's a few questions I would like to ask in relation to the report itself. The first one is in relation to the indicators themselves. As the lead officer said, there are annual reports, but in these it says annual indicators. We always had an up-to-date figure in relation to each particular
and piece of information that we require. It gives us an idea of which way we're travelling and which way we should be travelling. It's one we've had a lot of arguments over in the past. It's supporting measures on this page 38, at the very bottom line, shows the English average is 13.10, Northwest 10.10, Aldridge 12.10, which is a good thing to see. Do we know why we are doing better than the average in the Northwest? That's the first question. Well, it's the second question. The other comment, it's a comment more than a question, and it's in relation to the ones in the vibrant tourist economy. And it's picking up on points that Jerry Williams made earlier on. And in it, the council staff has successfully transferred the redelivery and delivery with elements of recognising festival, including the Arms Folks, State, etc., etc. It's an excellent thing that we've done. We've had a report to this committee, maybe last year, maybe just before. And that body of people is, what, 2.5 members of staff? Doing a fantastic job for this authority in the promotion of bringing people into the tourism. And we've seen before the amount of money that's been brought in and the increase in that. And we must congratulate those members of staff on doing that. That's the point I wanted to make on that one, Chair. That's it.
Thanks, Chair. In terms of the frequency of the reporting, I appreciate you asking that question before the meeting, because you asked a particular question about one which is biannual. The answer I had was that the ones where it's annual or biannual, it's because we're dependent on statistics from other organisations. The biannual ones are the UK Commission for Employment and Skills, so the decisions that are taken outside the council. In terms of the economy and the employment rate, I can get a more specific answer on that. I would hope that it's a result of work by ourselves and also by the Chamber, supporting businesses and start-up businesses and encouraging businesses to come to Wynn and grow. But I would like to get a more detailed answer on that. In terms of the tourism, yeah, it is a very small team. We have recently contracted with the Chamber of Commerce to provide additional support to that team. Particularly in respect of major events like the River of Light and the events that Rose referred to that are coming next year as well.
Steve. Thank you, Chair. Page 41, my normal contribution on people killed seriously injured. You remember on the last occasion we met, I wasn't giving a report there that was saying that we were doing well on these figures. And on this, on quarter one, I see that the target was for 23, the actual is 25, yet we're still showing this as green, showing that can't be good.
In 3, 2, 2, 1, 2, 3, paragraph down, €0.2 million spending on traffic and transportation. The shortfall in car park income of €0.1 million is due to delayed implementation of the increased tax and charges to the country parks. Was that decision made at the time of setting the budget? Did I find this in the reset?
It's built in as a saving and there's been delays in implementing it, and that's what we're expecting.
Built in as a saving. Thank you.
I think it's fair to say that, Dave, that the delay has been due to the fact that we're trying to do our best to get it right. Thanks, Dave.
Well, Steve. The question is, it was a predetermined decision.
Possibly. Well, no, it wasn't predetermined, it was built in. It's not about predetermination, it's just putting a figure in so the budget can balance.
This figure relates to the income which wasn't received because of the great deal of scrutiny this matter received a lengthy period of scrutiny, absolutely properly, but clearly in that time all this could be placed with equipment and contractors could be appointed and so on. So there was a delay in anticipating the building. Just while I'm speaking, I'll jump in back now. The road safety statistics are green because they're comparing it with the previous 2 years, so it's lower than quarter one last year than the year before, but I accept that it's not representative because it's presenting as a green for this first quarter. Actually, compared to the previous 2 years, it isn't a new green in terms of values in the third quarter.
Thanks, Chair. Thanks, Jenny. Page 52, where there's nearly $250,000 set aside for webcasting. Is that being discussed? Are we having it? Or is that a thing that we are going to accept at the moment? That's what we're going to be paying for.
My understanding is that that is the budgeted figure for that scheme at the moment. Obviously, as it develops, in the sense that it's early stages, that will get found up, but it isn't reported during the monitoring.
Okay. Anyone else? Jenny, thanks very much.
Thank you.
Item 9, policy information. And ask any members, is there anything arising from this report on the reforms? No?
Yes, Mr. Chair.
Noted. Agreed?
Agreed.
Item 10, this committee's work programme. We've already talked about the road safety issue, and I'd like to draw members' attention. That's going to be one of our items this year. We're going to look at the task committee. It is important. Now, members can remember, we looked at road safety, we had Dave Reese here who gave us a report, and since then that report's been annotated by the World Pedestrian Association, whose chair is Ian Campbell. Ian I know well, Steve also knows Ian. And he's produced an annotated report about the report that we got. And it's really the same. Steve highlighted when we had 25 deaths, and previously we had 23, and